feisty, fierce, and larger than life, Nancy Astor was described by one political contemporary as a woman of great effrontery, but also enormous charm. The first woman to take up a seat in Britain's House of Commons, Lady Astor was actually an American, born Nancy Witcher Langhorne in Virginia in 1879. One of five sisters noted for their beauty, the family lived in poverty until Nancy was a teenager, when her father suddenly acquired a fortune through railways. After a failed first marriage to a dissolute Boston socialite, Nancy moved to England with her favorite sister Phyllis, where she took London society by storm. Courted by several rich and influential men, Nancy chose fellow American Waldorf Astor, whose wealthy father later became a British peer. In Waldorf, Nancy had found someone as passionate about politics as she, and the couple also shared a commitment to charitable causes, becoming well known for their generosity. When Waldorf was forced to resign from the House of Commons in 1919 to take up his late father's position in the House of Lords, Lady Astor contested his seat in the ensuing by-election. Some women were ambivalent about her campaign, as she'd not been an active suffragette. And Lady Astor came up against politicians like Winston Churchill, who were horrified at the idea of women in politics.
Because I wanted the world to get better, and I knew it couldn't get better if it's going to be ruled by men. Matter of fact, I think it's amazing how well the men did for 2,000 years, considering they tried to do it alone. It was a good time then, and I remember Winston Churchill. He said to me once, "It's a very remarkable performance. We hope to freeze you out." When you entered the House of Commons, I felt like a woman had entered my bathroom and I'd nothing to protect myself with except a sponge.
Lady Astor proved to be a formidable politician, with a lack of pretension and a blunt manner that endeared her to a wide range of people. Her famous charm and flirtatious manner disguised a steely ambition and iron will. As a conservative, she had an unlikely friendship with socialist writer George Bernard Shaw, who called her a recklessly unladylike lady. Her political priorities were curbing alcohol consumption, improving education, and establishing maternity centers and creches. Lady Astor refused to toe the party line when she disagreed with it, and pledged to steer a middle course through contentious issues, often putting her at odds with her colleagues. Before World War II, her intense opposition to war and support of appeasement led to accusations that she was pro-Hitler. But when the war came, she was tireless in her efforts to keep up morale and risked her own life by staying with her Plymouth constituents, rather than retreating to the safety of her Cliveden estate. Nancy was also renowned for her comedic talent and delighted Christmas house parties with her acting skills. Among the extended family who joined her five younger children at Cliveden every holiday was niece Joyce Grenfell, who went on to become one of Britain's most famous comic actors. Grenfell recalled her aunt as an intimidating, dictatorial, but also amazingly generous woman. Lady Astor's habit of plain speaking and her lack of tact ultimately alienated both her political colleagues and her own family. She had impossibly high moral standards, but like many of her social set, was unthinkingly racist. She also hated communism, fascism, and Catholicism. Towards the end of her life, Nancy became less prejudiced against Catholics, although she maintained her opposition to communism. However, she strongly criticized the House Un-American Activities Committee's persecution of suspected communists during the late 1950s. Nancy Astor died in 1964, after a lifetime of fighting for what she believed. "The main dangers in this life," she once said, "are the people who want to change everything or nothing."